Welcome to the broadcast service for the United Parish of Killinchy, Kilmood and Tullynakill. This week we have the Bishop of Down and Dromore, the Right Reverend David McClay, as our guest preacher. Bishop David will be expounding the Acts of the Apostles.
Today's reading from the book of Acts, Acts chapter 6, beginning to read at verse 1. And our theme today is that of leadership. Now, in these days when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. And the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good report, full of the Holy Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. These they set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid their hands on them. And the word of God continued to increase, and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great number of the priests became obedient to the faith. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Stars of
So let's pray together as we turn to today's verses from Acts chapter 6, verses 1 to 7, the theme of leadership. Lord, I pray that all of us who are engaging with these verses, all who are listening online, all who are listening in any way, Lord, would you pour down upon us your life-giving Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, be our teacher, and also be the one that calls and equips and anoints us for leadership in today's church and in today's world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today we're moving to the second of this little series of talks for the summer. Three ships, discipleship, which we looked at last time. Today, leadership, and then on the next time, that of apostleship. And we're looking today at these verses in Acts chapter 6, verses 1 to 7, as we look at leadership together. I've chosen quite deliberately to ensure that leadership development will be something that will be at the very top of our diocese agenda over the coming number of years. While the world that you and I live in is almost unrecognizable when we compare it to the world of 50 years ago, never mind 100 years ago, things indeed have changed so much within this last 10 years that the challenges today that face today's leaders are many. And this is a really relevant subject that the church today should be putting at the very top of our agenda. That is the importance of leadership, the nature of leadership, and the need for godly leadership in every age within the Church of Jesus Christ. And today's reading begins by recognizing that back in Acts chapter 6, in this time in the early church, there was what you might call a leadership gap, a leadership need. And gaps in leadership, leadership needs continue in the church today and indeed have always been around. That shouldn't surprise us. Jesus said in Luke chapter 10, he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest field." The church in the book of Acts was in the very fortunate position that it was a growing church. It was a church that was increasing in numbers. The number of disciples was increasing all the time. But in Acts chapter 6 here in these verses, we discovered this leadership gap. And the gap was this: the well-being of the widows, whose cause God had promised to withhold and to really look after in the Old Testament, was being overlooked in verse 1. Now, in those days, when the disciples were increasing with number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. You see, the situation was the disciples had many tasks to turn their time and to turn their working day towards. They had to give time to pray. They needed to give time as well to preaching and to teaching God's word. And so the thing that seems to be being hit and being impacted here is the daily distribution of food. They're organizing their running of the food bank, particularly for the Hellenist widows. And the answer was not to neglect the care of the widows, nor was it to neglect their diligence in terms of preaching and teaching, or setting aside time to pray. What they needed to do was to fill the gap, to fill this leadership gap. So what they do is they set aside a group of leaders who would make this task of caring for the widows their task. Verse 2, "And the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, 'It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables.'" Now, it's not that some tasks are more important than other tasks. The challenge then, as now, is to raise up leaders and to raise up workers for all the tasks that need to be undertaken in the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. To raise up leaders to work and to serve and to lead in a wide variety of ministries within the Church. And so, in a recent diocesan address at Synod, I set before the Synod lots of goals in terms of ministry. I'm just going to mention a few of them. And I want to remind us of something. First of all, where are leaders found? Where are bishops and clergy and lay readers and Sunday school teachers found? Well, they're ordinary men and ordinary women who are part of our church families, who are already in our parishes, who are people, as here in the book of Acts, people of good report, people who are full of the Holy Spirit and of wisdom, people full of faith, people full of the Spirit of God, but they're ordinary people in ordinary pews that need to be identified, trained, equipped, released, and anointed, and sent out to lead. So, here's some of the challenges that I raised at our diocesan synod, just a few of the many that I raised on that day. Might you be called, for example, to train to become a diocesan lay reader who would preach and teach God's word? Might you be called to train to become a diocesan evangelist, or to become a youth worker, or a children's worker, or a family support worker? Or might you be someone that would sense a call to become part of our new diocesan year-out ministry apprentice scheme when it's set up for those in the age group of 18 to 25? And ministry, of course, is for people of all ages, young, middle-aged, and older. Might you be called, and might you present yourself to be someone who would be trained to become a pastoral visitor? Or how about getting involved in the work of your local select vestry? How about serving as a Sunday school teacher? How about working with young people? How about responding to the many ministry needs that are around us in today's church? The church today needs to identify and release men and women into leadership roles in our church and in our different parishes. And that's what happens here in these verses. In verse 3, we read, "Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Holy Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty." The church is told here to look out for potential leaders, to pick out, to discover who among them might be those that would become the potential leaders that are required in this particular context in Acts chapter 6. We're told that they need to be people of integrity. Character really, really matters. It matters above all else. They need to be people who are full of the Holy Spirit. Men and women who will continue to be filled with the Holy Spirit more and more and more. That's the only way to be full of the Spirit, is to go on being filled by the Spirit day by day. They, of course, need the right gifts, but more importantly, they need to be people who are full of wisdom. In other words, people who are teachable. Those who are growing and who are prudent and wise. They're the ones that are to be appointed here in Acts chapter 6. Godly leaders will always be men and women who, over a period of time, are being shaped by God's word. The best leaders, I do believe this, are found in prayer meetings. The best leaders are found at Bible study groups. The best leaders are found with open Bibles, men and women who will be reading God's word, men and women who humbly will be seeking the face of God and praying. Men and women who are present and engaged in worship. Those who are generous givers. Those too who have dealt and who continue to deal with issues in their lives that otherwise will restrict them and damage them and hold them back and make them inappropriate leaders. The truth that is in us, the integrity that is in us, the grace that is in us is the truth and the grace and the integrity that will lead others forward in the things of God, in the work of God, in the ways of God, and in the tasks that God entrusts to his church. Now, by that I'm not saying that all people who are called to lead will immediately be perfect. That's not true for any of us. But we ought to be those who are increasingly becoming more and more like Jesus and who are increasing in the Holy Spirit more and more and more. And so we read in verses 4 and following, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. These they set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid their hands upon them. We see here a humility, an openness, a desiring to walk a close walk and to be those that would be subject to those set over them in the Lord and who would be teachable and humble. All very important characteristics in leadership in today's church as in the church in Acts chapter 6. Elsewhere in the book of Acts, you find people like Aquila and Priscilla and Lydia, men and women from rich backgrounds, from poor backgrounds, all recognized as those that have leadership potential, all recognized as those who are called to lead and appointed then by the church to lead. God calls his whole church to ministry, and he calls different people to different ministries. And all ministry, friends, is service. Prayer is service. Preaching and teaching God's word is Christian service. Caring for people's needs, looking after the food bank, looking after the widows and others is service. And all Christian service requires Christian people. People who go on and on and on being filled more and more and more with the Holy Spirit. We follow the one, we follow Jesus who came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And God gives, generously gives a wide variety of gifts and ministries to his church. There's also a wide variety of ministries that are actually in society as well as in the church. In the world of politics, in the world of business, in the world of education, and in the world of arts. John Stott so beautifully captured this when he wrote, the expression full-time Christian ministry is not to be restricted to church work and missionary service. It can also be exercised in government, in the media, the professions, business, industry, and the home. We need to recover, he said, the vision of the wide diversity of ministries to which God calls his people. But God is looking today for godly leadership, for leaders who will lead like Jesus led, humble women and men who will love God, men and women who will be grateful, truly grateful for all that God has done for them, all that God has done in their lives. Leadership, men and women who will be people who are full of faith, who trust God and who go on trusting God even when life's tough, even when life is unfair, even when life is challenging, they will go on trusting and loving God. Leadership, men and women who are increasingly thankful and grateful that God has called them and chosen them, who never get over that just amazing privilege that God has called them to ministry. Servant-hearted people who serve others out of a reverent fear and love for Jesus Christ. And such leadership, such godly leadership yields a spiritual harvest. Verse 7 tells us the word of God continued to increase, and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great number of the priests became obedient to the faith. Leadership, it's key to growth in today's church. Leadership, it's key to transformation, even in the corridors of power in our society. Godly leadership, Christ-like leadership, leadership that reflects the leadership that we find in these seven verses in Acts chapter 6. We read in Acts 12 that the word of God grew and multiplied. It's just six chapters on from Acts chapter 6. The same Holy Spirit, the same Jesus, the same Savior, is the same Savior that we preach in today's world and proclaim from the pulpit of today's churches. The same Holy Spirit is the same Spirit that was available to the church, the early church, in Acts chapter 6. Some years ago now, I had the privilege of attending a church growth conference in the Diocese of Singapore. That was back in 1995, 1996. And that church has continued to grow under the leadership of different bishops and a variety of clergy and a variety of lay people, as leadership has been passed on from one generation to the next. And that church and the churches in that diocese have continued to grow and to increase, often planting other churches in Singapore, but also planting churches beyond in other parts of Asia, places like Cambodia and other parts of the nations around Singapore. Today's church in Nigeria, the Anglican Church, and other expressions of the Christian Church in Nigeria are multiplying and growing at a phenomenal rate. Wonder, did you realize that there's more Anglicans today in Nigeria than in the United Kingdom, the Republic of Ireland, North America, and Australia, and Europe, all added together? More Anglicans in Nigeria than in all of those Western nations added together. Is the Holy Spirit any different in Europe than he is in Singapore or in Nigeria? Of course he isn't. The key is that God would call and equip and raise up godly leaders who would seek the presence and the power of that same Holy Spirit, who would preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, who would proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, who would rise up and would meet the needs of the hour, just as that church in Acts 6 rose up to meet the needs of their day and of their generation, ensuring that there would be leadership at every level in the life of God's church. Let's, as a church, meet the needs of our hour, today's hour, and today's church for God's glory today. Let us pray. Lord God, leadership in your church is such a wonderful privilege. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of leadership. Thank you for those that have led us, for those that have impacted our lives, for those that have influenced our lives for good and for God. And I pray, Lord God, that you would raise up in all our parishes in these days men and women like those in Acts chapter 6 who would be full of your Holy Spirit, who would be full of faith, that the church would recognize and that the church, Lord God, would authorize to lead many to Jesus Christ and to lead in the manner that Jesus Christ would have us lead his church. So pour out your Holy Spirit and be pleased to raise up a whole new generation of leaders to respond to your call. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his glory and for the strengthening of his church. Amen.